Welcome back, and you're watching ASEAN Business Report. The Asian Development Bank, or ADB, is warning Indonesia over its over-reliance on banks for financing, urging development of the local bonds market to avoid liquidity mismatches in developing the long-term infrastructure projects. ADB Vice President of Finance and Risk Management said an over-reliance on loans to finance infrastructure would lead to liquidity mismatch, as banks normally finance long-term projects with short-term deposits, claiming that long-term bonds were a better choice. There has been strong appetite among global investors to invest in fast-growing bonds markets in Southeast Asian nations, and Indonesia has been suggested to tap investors' interest to accelerate its infrastructure development. Now, it is deemed that a well-developed bond market would provide a less expensive alternative source of funds for local corporations, most of which still depended on banks' loans to support the expansion. In Indonesia, executives frequently complain of the high cost of loans as local banks charge higher interest rates than their peers in Southeast Asia. And adding to that, Indonesia could also be seen to resolve its high interest rate predicament to attract more investors to the local government and corporate bond markets.
And we also have an analysis on Indonesia economic forecast by DBS.
On the Indonesian economy this year, here are some of the important points. First, the domestic demand story is still intact. GDP growth is expected to reach around 6.3% and 6.5% in 2013 and 2014, respectively. Second, the current account deficit should narrow this year on the back of an improvement in exports and modest credit tightening. Third, Bank of Indonesia is unlikely to favor further rupiah weakness to facilitate the current account deficit adjustment, especially with inflationary pressures rising. Fourth quarter GDP growth reached 6.1% year-on-year, taking full year 2012 growth to 6.2%. Although headline growth is slightly slower compared to the 6.5% registered in 2011, the overall GDP growth number does point to resilience in the domestic economy despite significant external headwinds. In fact, domestic private sector performance was stronger in 2012 compared to 2011. Notably, private consumption growth and investment growth reached 5.3% and 9.8% respectively in 2012, compared to 4.8% and 8.8% respectively in 2011. The overall economic slowdown was due in large part to net exports, which took away 1.3 percentage points from headline growth. Going forward, external headwinds should become tailwinds amid stabilization in the major economies and a turnaround in China. Aside from an expected increase in external demand, commodity prices should become more favorable, reducing concerns on external funding. Domestically, growth momentum remains strong, even if there have been some signs of softening on the investment front. Inflation is going to be a concern down the line, and the central bank or Bank of Indonesia may embark on modest tightening to reduce price pressures and further reassure on external imbalances. GDP growth is expected to reach 6.3% and 6.5% in 2013 and 2014, respectively. The strength of the domestic economy relative to the rest of the world has placed some stress on the external accounts. Last year, the current account deficit widened to $7.7 billion in the fourth quarter from $3.1 billion in the first quarter. The economy also registered the first full-year current account deficit since the Asian financial crisis, amounting to 2.7% of GDP. Cyclical factors have contributed to depressed commodity prices, while continued investment-led growth resulted in an increase in capital goods imports. Accordingly, almost the entire shift in the current account surplus in 2011 to a deficit in 2012 was due to the deterioration in the trade balance. Domestically, a further adjustment in the current account is likely to take place through higher interest rates and/or further macroprudential measures aimed at tightening loan growth. Externally, A moderate bounce in the commodity prices will help lift exports. DBS expects an uneven return to surplus in the trade balance in the coming months, thereby cutting down the current account deficit to 1.5% of GDP in 2013. Price pressures are building amid a robust domestic economy and are starting to be reflected in the inflation numbers. Inflation came in at 5.3% year-on-year in February, the highest level in 20 months, as food prices stay elevated due to floods that took place in January. Higher electricity tariffs also contribute to the higher inflation rate. Moreover, rupiah weakness is likely to lead to higher imported inflation, highlighting Bank of Indonesia's dilemma as it grapples with a widening current account deficit. Notably, the January inflation figure is already at the higher end of Bank of Indonesia's inflation target range of 3.5 to 5.5%. Increased vigilance towards price pressures are likely this year, and DBS expects a modest increase in the FASBI deposit rate in the coming quarters. DBS has recently revised up its inflation forecast for 2013 to 5.3% from 4.9% previously. This projection is contingent on the government staying pat on subsidized fuel prices.
Now let's get back to Thailand. After 7 years of suspension, Thailand is considering resuming trade talks with four European countries under the European Free Trade Association. The four countries are Switzerland, Norway, Iceland, and Liechtenstein. Pyu Ramon Jeroen Pau, Director General of the Trade Negotiations Department, said yesterday that Thailand will soon hold public hearings, and after that, the pact will be sent to Parliament for endorsement under Article 190. The pact is expected to help promote trade and investment as well as to liberalize services and technology transfers. European countries are ahead in technology development. The first of four public forums for this year is set for March the 25th in Khon Kaen, with a seminar on FTA Thailand EFTA opportunities and challenges. The Commerce Ministry has reported that EFTA is one of the high potential markets for Thailand, as trade has been increasing each year. Average trade during the past 3 years was $12.56 billion. Last year, two-way trade reached $13.45 billion, and trade negotiations between Thailand and EFTA were last held in 2006.
And now we turn on to our special interview with Dr. Surin Pitsuwan, the former ASEAN Secretary General, as he has recently agreed to chair the Future Innovative Thailand Institute, which is a think tank formed to draw up a new blueprint for Thailand. And this will also focus on three areas, which is education, economy, and governance. Kuntanong Kantong, our editor of C Channel, has this.
How do you see your new role, and what do you want to accomplish?
Well, I think Thailand needs to be more competitive, more prepared when we go into the larger field of the ASEAN community, and then through ASEAN, certainly with the global community. Thailand has to be prepared more than this in the areas of education, preparing our human resources, our future leaders for competition in the global community, in the ASEAN community. We need to put our house in order in the area of governance, corruption, leakages of resources, and lack of transparency in the implementation, in the disbursement of our resources, our budget. The other one is the way in which we have implemented our development strategy and development policy. Our growth has been rather impressive, 5-6%, 7% a year, and the GDP growth, GDP volume is expanding every year, but there's a lot of inequality in the system, there's a lot of tension in the system, lack of equity, lack of inclusivity. This has led to instability, insecurity, and a lot of social tensions, political problems between us and among us. I think this need to be corrected. So I am taking over this institute in order to lead the efforts to find measures and answers to some of these fundamental issues and problems of Thailand, with an aim to prepare the Thai people, Thailand, better.
Do you think that your plan is too ambitious because you are trying to draw a blueprint for Thailand, you know, over the next 10 or 20 years?
Well, somebody...
And you have to compete with the blueprint, you know, from other organizations.
Well, no, you know, somebody has to do it, and I don't think we are in a position to monopolize this effort. The more the better, the more the merrier. I would like to see the Thai people questioning their governments, questioning their government agencies, their officials, their politicians more. And I would like to invite the media to come in and let's analyze, let's do investigative reporting, let's follow and scrutinize public policies, government projects more aggressively, more effectively, and certainly with more information than this, so that the public will benefit. In the end, they will be more informed and they can make an informed decision on whom they want, what they want for their government, for the policies that would involve them, would benefit them, or would avoid policies that might have negative impact upon them and their livelihood.
And we are now taking another short break, and we'll be right back with an update from Japan as the new Bank of Japan chief has vowed to fight deflation. Stay tuned for more details.